So you've been part of a conversation and have listened to the other conversation.
Yeah.
So
yeah, they were fantastic. Fantastic.
Yeah. So this is the fourth, and this is, we're kind of like, I don't know, not cleanup crew, like what would you call it? The wrap up a little, or the not wrap up, because it's not,
I think
not
we
stopping.
Just get the joy of actually like sitting down and processing what we've heard together. Like hundreds of others who in our church have watched those videos. We just get the delight of doing it together. So hopefully this will be a conversation that is modeled across our church as well of taking the things that you've now watched and ingested and process.
Yeah. I was having a conversation with Kelsey, one of our SALT staffers yesterday, and we were talking about movies, and she was saying how she hates going to movies alone because she likes to be able to talk about it afterwards with someone. Well, if you go alone, there's no conversation partner, you know. So it's a little bit like that.
Yeah.
Where, and I think part of it too, so instead of a movie, what we have right now laying out before us are a lot of events, I mean, we're on social media, we read and watch the news, like there's a lot of things happening that we're kind of watching, maybe from a distance, maybe up close, depending on who you are, but to be able to have conversation partners where there's a lot of grace. And we've said this kind of along the way, where it's like you need those friends with different experiences from different backgrounds that you can ask stupid questions to.
Absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
So I think one of the big takeaways for me in that, like in this whole ongoing process, has been, it's been really interesting to me the distinction between how when I sit down across the table from people, the conversation is very reasonable or cordial. Like even if we don't agree, it's very, reasonable is probably the best word. Whereas you go on social media and the news and all that stuff, it seems very unreasonable. That I did not expect that distinction. Maybe I'm just naive. I didn't expect it to be that wide where you turn your phone off, that's unreasonable. You sit across a table from someone and now you're talking to a human and not just a screen.
Well, each of the conversations were profound in different ways, but I, on conversation three, loved, I think Scott was the one who quoted Dr. Brian Loritz, who said, proximity builds empathy.
Yeah.
And I think that's the missing component within social media or even just media in general. Like when you turn on the news, it seems like it's so one-sided. You're constantly yelling past each other, or there's you're attacking a straw man that's like that. And when you're the one that's getting attacked, like that isn't what I believe. That's not, I don't affirm that. I wouldn't say that. And there's something about the conversation that humanizes it a bit of even if I walked into the conversation knowing that we flat out disagree, there's just this human desire to want to, though, like throw arms around each other. I mean, isn't there? It seemed to be. And so proximity, because conversations happen and create some level of closeness, it builds that empathy. And I think that we're just missing that as a culture. Well, and maybe that's a product of COVID as well. You know, isolation, all this, I don't think it helps for sure. And so, man, I've been so grateful for the discipline of like slow down, create space. I think conversations are a discipline. Like you have to sometimes force yourself in the heat of the moment to slow down and ask some questions and talk.
Yeah. So, well, that's funny you brought up the COVID thing, because it is amazing to me how these two things correlate, where if proximity breeds empathy, which I really think it does, I think that was such a great thing that Scott brought up, you go, proximity breeds empathy, and we have been social distancing for months now. Luckily, we can sit across the table, but I mean, there's times there where it's like, good luck finding a context to even have people at your dinner table, you know? And so the proximity in these last several months has continued to get further and further apart, and it seems as though the empathy or the lack of empathy has just kind of followed suit.
And now empathize with me, a guy who loves physical touch.
Right.
and I can't hug somebody. It's like, I think the world needs a few more hugs right now. And that's like all I want to do.
Dude, you're the free hug guy.
I know. You can do that. Yeah.
You and Lance DeWine.
Yeah, get send out me there the shirt, man. I'll wear it.
You know, something else that's been interesting, and it didn't necessarily play out in the conversations, mm-hmm. but even just watching social media and the news, reading the news, it seems as though there's been an emergence, and it's been there for a while, I think, but it's just been accentuated by this time, of a kind of almost what you call like a red evangelicalism mm-hmm. and a blue evangelicalism, where it's like, as Christians, what we have is we have like a profound commitment to racial justice. And so honoring the image of God in every person, recognizing that they bear the image of God and are inherently valuable and worthy of respect and dignity and honor and to be treated fairly and justly because they're created by God himself right. and bear his image. Like we believe that as believers, we have a concern for the poor and the marginalized. That's mm-hmm. what we see in scripture. We also see in scripture that Christians are pro-life, mm-hmm. that we care for the lives of the unborn. And we see in scripture that human sexuality is to be shown and played out in the context of a man and a woman mm-hmm. in the context of marriage for life. So if those are the four right. kind of categories, it seems as though people tend to emphasize only two of them and minimize two of them. And what can kind of happen is the pro-life and heterosexuality, you could say, is automatically a Republican issue, and the pro-justice, pro-poor and marginalized is automatically a Democrat issue. And it's almost as though right. these two can't go together. So if you start to talk about one, you get labeled and put in a camp, you
right.
know? And that, to me, I go, it seems like Christianity, it not just seems like, it is a fact that Christianity cares about all of these things.
Right.
And so if we are more defined by red or blue, that's a problem. Mm. And we actually should be this kind of conglomeration of purple, probably, if we're living out a Christian biblical ethic and worldview. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And so it's been amazing to see that those polar ends, which existed before this time, but it's just, it seems to be accentuated, right?
Well, and that polarization of society, I mean, Satan loves to divide. Mm. He loves to bring disunity. And it's one level to bring disunity within the church. Then it'd be another thing to bring disunity between the church and even the world that we're called to love and to pursue with the gospel. Mm. And so, yeah, there's going to be differences, but not like a us versus them mentality that can get created. And right now, society is in love with the us versus them narrative. They we're trying to find groupings. And I think it really all gets back to, like, we were talking about this the other day, like, identity. Like, what is going to be our identity? And for Christians, our identity has to be in Christ. I mean, it has to be in Christ. And anything else that may be a part of our life, if that thing starts to supersede our identity in Christ, and I want us to like just pause for a moment, like, because these other things can be good things, can be helpful things, especially as we talk about a church that values diversity. The fact that a person is white or black or has a political affiliation or whatever, like, it's part of who that person is, but that identity can't supersede who they are in Christ because it is the blood of Christ that bonds us together and breaks down all of those barriers by which we can then engage the world. And I think one of the things I'm most nervous of in my own heart and mind, and I'm most nervous for within our own church, is that if we begin to walk down an us versus them road, not only will we maybe withdraw from the world around us that needs Jesus so bad, but we actually might make enemies out of people that need Christ. Because there really are, there's two groupings of people in the world. There are those who are in Christ and those who need Christ.
Mm.
And those who are in Christ are called to go to those who need Christ. And so
they love and prefer.
And so it doesn't shock me when the world around me doesn't affirm my worldview.
Mm.
Christianity was never meant to be mainstream. It's just, I don't see that in scriptures. And so when people come up to me that are shocked, that they were talking to a neighbor. It's like, man, they don't even believe this. It's like, really? We're the weird ones, man. Yeah. And so don't put me in a box. I'm gonna be in the Team Jesus box and let that define everything else. And I think if there's one major prayer request that I have, like, for our church, I just want to continue to pray this over our church, is that it would be Jesus that would define us as we engage these issues, and that we wouldn't come at it as purely, well, I'm black and a Christian, or I'm white and a Christian, or I'm a Republican, pro-life Christian, or whatever defining things, but the identity in Christ has to supersede. I mean, what would you say to that?
Yeah, I mean, it really speaks to the multiplicity of ways then that preferences and personal beliefs, stuff like that, like, plays into, like, now, because my primary identity is in Christ, that means that I can lay aside every preference that I would have. So so this isn't as much a racial thing, but it has been amazing how even, like, wearing masks has become politicized. Yeah. And even as we decided to go to an 8 a.m. like mask required service, it's something that people can assume a political agenda into, when it's like, really?
Yeah.
You think we literally, all we're trying to do is set aside our preferences for the sake of loving others?
Yeah,
that means I got to wear a mask to do that. Awesome.
Right. Doesn't it follow Paul's logic?
Yes,
I become
absolutely
all things to all people that I might possibly win some. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just trying to remove things that would be barriers to helping the gospel get to somebody. And so we need to, I think, continue to figure out what hills we're willing to, as a church, like, hey, we need to stand firm on those grounds and not give up any ground. Mm-hmm. But also at the same time, continue to think hard about how to engage our world around us in ways that are very intentional with the gospel. And I think COVID has given us opportunities for that. I think the conversation surrounding the death of George Floyd and race and justice gives us opportunities for that, because it begins to engage what people really value. And I think it begins to engage people that are hurting.
Mm.
And again, proximity builds empathy. And so to get close to people, throw arms around them, begin to walk with them, not making it a political thing, but making it about the gospel and helping that person walk with Jesus, and then, you know, engaging others with that.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the church is supposed to do.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's that identity that shapes everything else.
Yeah. I think another thing that I've noticed is, it seems, and this is my own perception, obviously, it seems as though generalizations is the prevailing argument of the day.
Yeah, what do you mean by that?
Where statements are made, where and things are spoken about in fairly general terms. All police officers are like this. All of this group are like this. All of this group are like this. And it's interesting because, I mean, you think of even in a marriage relationship, we parent our kids this way to really avoid using the words always and never.
Yeah.
But what in that, though, like, as I parent my kids, and even as I try to communicate, usually what's happening, though, when my child is saying, well, you always do this, though they're using a generalization that may not be fair, what's informing that is usually specific events. Mm-hmm. And so while I want to, like, parent them out of using the generalizations, I don't want to at the same time sweep under the rug the specific things that have actually hurt them, are informing what's happening, you know. Yeah. And so really drawing out from my kids, like, what specifically happened? Help me understand this, you know, and not just go, because I disagree with the generalization, that I throw the baby out with the bathwater, as it were, you know. And I can see that tendency in me to go, well, because I don't agree with your just, like, massive statement that's reductionistic and I don't think is true, then, well, everything you say isn't worth listening to. It's like, no, it's probably been informed, though, by specific instances that are really important to talk about, you know.
Well, and one bit of advice I've kind of gone back to over and over again over the past few months for a number of different reasons and contexts, but this is a bit of advice that has saved me from myself in my marriage. But it was Matt Chandler, I think it's within Mingling of Souls, that he talks about the importance of, in marriage, matching feelings with feelings, facts with facts. And I think so often a mistake takes place relationally when somebody expresses their feelings. And we know that feelings aren't always true. Just as because somebody experienced something doesn't mean that that is true. Mm-hmm. Okay, you experienced that. Does that mean that that's true of everybody? That's true of everybody in that situation, whatever. Mm. So experiences don't mean truth, and feelings aren't always truth. But when somebody is expressing their feelings, to be immediately met with facts is the worst way that we can respond to somebody else.
Mm.
And if we could pause and actually, instead of, you know, that person expresses feelings, I'm gonna respond with facts, to pause a bit and to draw that out and to match it also with our own feelings. Okay, you felt that, this is what I'm feeling. Then it gives you some legs to stand on, like a foundation then to engage in the facts.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I think that's just a massive mistake I see played out constantly on different platforms in the world around us right now. That's like, man, we're not being very empathetic with each other. And two, we're being very mean.
Mm.
And relationally, we're missing the mark over and over again in just loving the people around us. And so,
I mean, one thing I think worth highlighting in what you just said was, what you didn't say is that facts don't matter, but the order matters a lot.
Oh yeah.
As we engage with people at a feelings level, I remember that was one of the critiques of J.D. Greer's J.D. Greer talking about Black Lives Matter and all that stuff. And one of the if you just read the comment threads, which I don't know why I ever do that, because it's like. It's like going to the dump, you know? Yeah, it's like we just look at all this garbage. Yeah. It never makes you feel better, right? Like you're just like, oh man, things are broken. But it was like people were just railing on him because it was like, well, have you read this statistic and all this stuff? And like what are you saying? Facts don't matter. And it's like, no, he's not saying facts don't matter. It's not as though facts don't matter. Facts matter a lot. Right. But it's the way in which you engage with someone that can really determine whether those facts will have any bearing in the conversation. If I just try to engage you as a scientist, which I'm not a scientist, but as though I were one, as a keyboard warrior who happened to read 3 articles and I'm an expert on something, which also never happens, you know, like I'm not going to be able to even have any ground to stand on, you know? So I think the order you put that in was really good.
Well, and you've heard me say these things repeatedly to our staff team in a variety of contexts. And I'm actually going to remind our staff team of these phrases, these kind of one-liners here in just a few weeks, because I think we're headed into a very interesting fall.
Mm.
But I think as the church, we could model this well. But if we could just assume the best, like even knowing JD, JD's a fantastic pastor and a great godly man. And we're all going to make mistakes. I'm not even going to say what he did there was made a mistake. Even if he did, I would go, okay, assume the best, lean toward trust, and go and have direct conversations as soon as possible.
Yeah. Yep.
If we could just as a society get really good at those 3 things, like just assume the best, lean toward trust, and then go have direct conversations instead of the opposite is always we assume the worst. I mean, we just assume the absolute, oh, their motives. And we think we got it all figured out. So then we go tell everybody around us, like, oh, this is what's going on. And it's suspicion. There's conspiracy. This is where they're going down a slippery slope. For sure, you start here. They're going to be there a year from now. You start spreading poison all over the place. And then the worst part, the thing that I hate the most, and I talked about this a few months ago when we were talking about James and the importance of watching our words.
Yeah.
Is then if we even eventually have that conversation, we go and have that direct conversation and it gets cleared up. Or JD releases a second video where he clarifies what he says and the heart behind it. And you go, oh, okay, I get it now. Well, are you going to go back and like clean up the mess? Are you going to go talk to the 20 people that you poisoned their mind? And we don't, but that lingers out there.
Yeah.
And that continues to infect the world around us. And then we get surprised when all of a sudden that bites us someday, and So I think those three things could make a huge difference. Oh man, for us.
Huge. I mean, not just because we're leaders in the church, and it's like, can you just kind of be nicer? Like, that's not the point. The point is, like, love bears all things, hopes all things, believes all things. Like, yeah. Like, love does assume the best. We see that in Scripture. And so a culture of suspicion and assuming motives, like, is the opposite heart posture of what is to define Christians with each other and with the world at large.
I one of my takeaways from these conversations is a reminder that unity has to be fought for. It's not something that just happens like naturally, that like you gravitate toward unity. Like, no, you are always drifting away from it and you have to fight for it. It's Ephesians 4:3. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. I mean, so it requires effort to fight for unity. And as a church, it's a worthwhile thing to fight for unity of the body. I think reminding ourselves of our primary identity that supersedes everything, our identity in Christ, and then to go out as a united front to engage the world, that they can see in us the gospel on display. They can see us proclaiming it with one voice. And now it's actually having dramatic impact. And so I think right now, as much as there's things in this world that can be discouraging, I don't know if there's ever been a better time to be a Christian or to be in the church than now. Because if we can be the church now, I don't know of any other time in my lifetime. Now, I'm not super old, but in our lifetime, where the ability to be the church will set you apart even more than now.
Yeah.
A bright light in a dark world. And so that's exciting.
Yeah.
That's really exciting.
Yeah, it really is an opportunity, though. The tendency could be to fear the opposition we may be walking into. We are walking into. We see that in Scripture. We shouldn't be surprised when we face opposition and persecution.
Yeah.
But this is an opportunity to be set apart as a distinctive community that embraces love with one another.
Yeah. So can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
You've been a part of all of these conversations, sitting at this table. What for you is kind of your big takeaway or even an observation or something from those conversations?
Yeah, probably one of the more helpful, as I think through how I live and leading my family, was talking to Josh and Andrea, and even hearing what they had to say, even about real little simple practical things, like even being aware. So my daughter's 7, she plays with dolls. How much racial representation is there even in her toys?
Right.
You know, like, which seems like a very small thing, but it's little things that help shape a worldview and an appreciation of cultures, you know? And so even for my wife and I, was like, oh man, that's really, really good. You know, so even for us as a family, trying to think through, how do we continue to help broaden our children's and our own worldview, our interaction and awareness? Again, proximity breeds empathy. How can I get more proximity to other nations, other people groups, other colors, other cultures? Like, how can we bring that into our home in a way that really highlights the beauty of that? You know, so real simple things like every night, and we'll talk about this in a couple Sundays. I don't know if this will be out before then, but every night we read the Bible together, we sing and we pray, of course. And sorry. And so what we do in our prayer time now is, not only will we kind of go around the room like, Naomi, how can I pray for you? Judah, how can I pray for you? We've got a globe and a map, like, on our wall. And we'll have the kids just go and point to a country. And we'll look that country up and a few little things about it and kind of talk about it. It takes, like, 3 minutes because of Google, you know. And we'll pray for that country and for that culture and what's happening in that country. Just real little things. And we'll look at pictures with the kids, and they can see the different ways that people dress, the different foods that they eat, the different things that are happening in that part of the world. Like, that's been a thing. Like I said, being aware of the cultures and the races that are represented in our kids' books and their toys and their TV shows. You know, so even last Friday night, Friday night's our family movie night, and so we watched Remember the Titans with the kids, and it was an amazing opportunity to pause all throughout the movie and explain to them what was going on, what was the basis of these racial tensions, why do these groups not like each other, and why are they being treated this way, and what you know, it was so beautiful. And to even then put them to bed that night, and particularly Naomi because she's older, you know, Judah loves, you know, is more into the football thing, but still for her to be wrestling with the racial tension that she just saw portrayed in this movie, and was a really beautiful thing.
How old is Naomi?
She's 7.
Yeah. That was one of my takeaways, you know, with Josh and Andrea and then Josh and Yachty. I mean, they're having these conversations with their kids at a young age.
Yeah.
And I think, as you know, it could be that there's parents out there that are going, well, I'm just waiting for my kid to be a bit more mature to be ready to handle this. And I think what I took away from those conversations was just being intentional from the earliest of ages, in age appropriate ways, but to have this conversation and to invite it into your living room. And so, yeah, for Naomi at age 7, for you to be processing that with her and praying with her and that, because our kids are very perceptive. They know what's going on in the world. There's conversations happening around them. They're catching bits and pieces. They're seeing certain things, and it's helping them process that all and then to engage it with a gospel lens. And if we're not, as parents, you know, there's a pun intended here, as you pause the movie of Remember the Titans, if we don't pause life and have a conversation now, shame on us.
Yeah,
for sure.
Absolutely.
Man, that's good.
What about you? I mean, as you've watched, listened, things you've done in your family, like...
Yeah, I first want to say this. I love our church and I love our people. I just, you know, hearing aspects of Josh and Andrea's story, I didn't know. Josh and Yachty, I mean, they were in our first connection group when we moved to town here a handful of years ago. We've been friends with them as long as we've been friends with anybody in the Cedar Valley. And even I didn't know the different nuances of Yachty's story. So I'm listening to it, both feeling ashamed as a friend, but also at the same time loving it, because I love the rich mosaic, you know, of God's work and who he's brought into Kendale Church that makes us a beautiful place, you know? And so I really delight in that. Mm. And I would say trying to take this back to the home level has been the biggest takeaway for us, like how to have this conversation as a family. Even kind of a bold move, you know, but my boys, they've got a neighbor friend that will spend quite a bit of time at our house, and I'm going to start charging him pretty soon for all the food that he eats at our dinner table. But what I love is, you know, one of the challenges I threw out to our people in the midst of this is like, do you ever have people of different skin colors sitting at your dinner table and eating food? Well, this kid would be one of those for us. And I'm teaching my boys to both like not see color, make it a big deal, but at the same time also like celebrate diversity. I mean, those two things at the same time.
Yeah.
And so in the midst of all of this, he's sitting at our dinner table, he's eating my food, so I figured I could ask him a question that kind of put him on the spot.
Is that how that works?
No. I love this kid. I hope that he listens to it, his parents listen to this, I get a laugh out of this. But I just decided to ask him, like, hey, you know, can I ask you a question that may be a bit too personal? I mean, if it is, just ignore it. We'll move on. Totally fine. And he's a very open kid. He's a very talkative kid, very outgoing kid. And so I felt pretty safe. And he's junior high age, you know, so he's not too young. But just asked him, I said, have you felt like anybody has ever treated you differently because of the color of your skin? Now, this is at my dinner table where I've got a 10-year-old, a 9-year-old, a 6-year-old, and a 3-year-old.
Mm.
And I just wanted them to know, like, this is how we have these conversations. This is how you have conversations with your friends. And so I've got a 12-year-old here that I want to talk. I want to be able to engage on things like this, especially in this moment. Classic form of a junior hire, his response was not totally what I expected, but he just goes, no. And that was it, just a quick response. I'm like, okay. And so I'm trying to think through like even how to like wrap that up, you know, because it was so quick and over.
Not the heart level
conversation
you were expecting.
Which again, sure. I'm like, I praise God for that. Like, I'm glad that that's your experience. And so just to then communicate to him, like, well, Eli, just know, like, our family loves you.
Mm.
And if there's ever a situation where that is the case, just know that we've got your back.
Mm.
I mean, just trying to throw arms around people to our right and left and just care for them. And so I think recognizing that our kids are going to model our behavior.
Yeah.
And it's a really important thing that we raise the next generation in a way that they can engage these conversations well.
Mm.
And so that's probably a big takeaway.
Yeah, I mean, even as you talk, I think I felt that challenge in the same way for some of my African-American friends, like even calling them up or getting lunch, whatever. And honestly, just going, hey, we've known each other for a while, and I've never asked you what your experience has been as a Black man in the Cedar Valley. Like, one, to like apologize for that. Cause honestly, for me, it was like, I felt like I wasn't being a good friend, you know? And I think part of it was cause I didn't want to make it weird, or I don't know. It felt like an awkward question to ask or whatever, but that was more my own pride. I don't know what it was, you know, that prevented me from doing that sooner, you know? Mm-hmm. And so it was a really great opportunity to like own that as a friend, be like, I feel like I haven't been a good friend to you in this way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not that I failed you categorically, but like, this is something that we haven't talked about. And I'd just love to hear your experience, you know?
Yeah.
So even as you like talk about that, it's like, that's not a weird, in every conversation, I'm like, I think I felt like it was weird, and I've just been affirmed over and over. It's like, that's not a weird thing to ask, you know?
Yeah.
I was the one who made it awkward in my own heart
and
kept from honestly loving them in a way that I think was holistic.
Right. Every human being, though, they wants to be known, wants to be cared for. And the only time that I think we can even have platforms to speak into people's lives, you know, and to bring truth is when they know that we genuinely care about them. And so that's just what friends do. And I think if you want to have gospel impact wherever you are, that's the investment. And it has to be sincere, but that's the investment you have to make in the lives of people around you. And it's why I want to continue to press myself to have a diverse grouping of friends, people within our church, outside the walls of our church, people that are Christ followers, people that aren't yet Christ followers, all of those things, because I think it continues to give me avenues to grow as a person, to love people well, and then to be very intentional with the gospel for the purposes of the name of Jesus becoming more famous.
Mm.
And that's what I want to give my life to. It's what we give our lives to as a church. And so we have to think creatively and purposely about that, and we have to be motivated by the genuine love of Christ that's been poured out on us, man. If God, who we were enemies of his,
could not be more different.
Couldn't be more different.
And
in hostility toward God.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's not like we were neutral. In hostility toward God would come all the way over to redeem us, doing all the hard work himself. I mean, we offer nothing to reconcile us to himself. Then yes, if that gospel is where I stake my hope, and that has been what transforms and changes my life, and that's the beauty, the glorious truth on which I now stand, how could I not extend myself over to a neighbor, to another resident of the Cedar Valley, motivated by that?
Yeah.
Man, I mean, if not, then there's got to be some serious questions about whether I've actually ever experienced that grace and understood the divide between God and myself. That's the miracle, that could be reconciled. Bringing Black people and white people together, Republicans and Democrats, that's easy compared to what God has already accomplished for us in Christ. And so let's let the gospel do its work and be restorative to
our
people.
Man, that's huge. I mean, if we could grasp the truth that the way that I think about and interact with someone who's different than me, racially, culturally, politically, politically, with all capital letters, right? Like, if I don't
said that twice,
if I don't understand that the way that I think about and interact with people different than me, that's a direct reflection of how I understand the gospel, because of what you just said. Me and God could not have been more different. He's God. I'm not. It's not just like two people. This is like God and me, perfect and sinful, like alive and dead. Like in every way, God and I are different. And yet this was the action that God in his, we could call it a privileged status, how he acted toward me. If that doesn't inform the way that, that I interact with other people, regardless of who they are, I don't understand the gospel. I just don't. It's clear and simple like that, you know? And so in the way that I use social media, the way that I talk about people around my dinner table, the way that I parent my kids, it's like, it must be informed by the gospel.
Yeah, and God forbid, and I need to repent of this, if like the primary thing that occupies the words that come out of our mouths is annoyance with how COVID is changing the world around us or affecting the openness of stores that I want to go to. You know, if that becomes my primary conversation with neighbors, or God forbid I get focused on certain aspects of what's happening around me because of the race and justice conversation that needs to happen, but the parts of it that I go, oh, I take issue with, or whatever, God forbid that that becomes the focal point of all of our conversations and all our interactions with those around us. And we look back on this time when the message of Jesus was needed so badly and go, man, you know what? One thing I didn't talk about was the hope of Jesus in this. And sadly, one of the things I didn't model very well was the joy that I found in Jesus. In fact, I walked around kind of kicking the dirt too a little bit as kind of a grumbler in this time. Man, God forbid if that's true. And sadly, that is true more of me in days than I would like to admit.
Oh, man. You're not alone in that. So both of us here got to repent of that, man. Well, this, at the expense of wrapping up a conversation here, somehow reflecting an ending of conversations ongoing, like that's not the, that hasn't been the point of these all along. But thanks so much for jumping in to this conversation, the other ones that we've had. And I know that our desire for our church would be that that these would be ongoing, that this would become a rhythm and a lifestyle of us as a people at Candeo. We'd sit across the table from people different than us with different experiences and even different beliefs, and come into that situation asking questions, looking to empathize and understand and love people as those who are made in the image of God. So.
Now, thanks for Jake initiating these conversations, making them happen, bringing them to life in this environment, and just for your friendship, man. You're one of the people I can go to have these conversations, and I hope that that people across our church can continue to build on friendships like this to have these conversations and to be changed by them. Conversations that can sometimes be used as like a detour from action, but good conversations, like held in the right way with humble hearts at the table, do change us.
Absolutely.
And I want us to grow as a church and be changed in that.